working, everybody. Wow, what a crowd, huh? I tell you, when the sun comes out again and the wind's blowing, y'all show up. And what amazes me is you show up when it's raining, too. It amazes me. And there's some people over here that came from Leesburg. Leesburg. They told me they came all the way from Leesburg for church this morning. And I said, you people are crazy. But, you know, a couple weeks ago we had a guy here that came all the way from Africa. So you guys got nothing on him. Today is the big day with our Christmas float. And Wendy and Paula and a lot of people put in their effort into getting ready for that today. So if you're going to be downtown this afternoon, we'll be at the church office putting the Christmas float together. I want to remind all of you men that Mondays at 7 a.m. is our men's prayer breakfast at the Potbelly Deli. If you don't know where it is, it's in the arcade building, the corner of US 1 and Orange. And you go around the back of the building and you'll find the Potbelly Deli back there. 7 o'clock on Mondays, we get done sharp at 8, so it won't make you late for work, if you work. If you're retired, you can stay and have coffee and shoot the breeze, but not all of us are retired. Shoot the breeze, 7 o'clock tomorrow. He'll be just getting out of the gym about 6. Yeah, 7 o'clock. Potbelly Deli. Okay, what else do we have going on? I don't have a bulletin with me. Danny is thinking about starting up a Friday daytime alpha class. Thank you. Friday daytime alpha class, and his phone number is on the back of the bulletin on the Friday section. If you're interested in doing something in the daytime and going through the alpha series, a lot of people say they can't make it in the evening, but I know there's a lot of retired folks that want to learn more. So get with Danny, and he's going to start building a list, and then you guys can decide whether you want to do it at 10:30 in the morning or 1 in the afternoon. So that's important to do that. I also want to let you know that after the first of the year, on the second Wednesday of January, we're starting a new series called The Boundaries DVD. We've done it before, but we're going to do it again. And then after that, I'm shooting for a series called Wild at Heart. So if you're interested in that, just be aware of Wednesdays. And Bob, of course, is continuing his studies on Mondays at 7 at the church office. This is Mondays at 7, Wednesdays at 7. We have continual learning. I think Bob has a couple of Mondays off at the end of the year. You got one more class, and then you're going to start the second Monday of next year? Yep, second Monday of next year. He'll start back up at 7 o'clock. And any idea where you're headed with a study yet? A Paul Ellis book. Yep, good. All right. So that's all going on. If you come to be in the parade today, we would ask that you dress like a who. A who? A who. Who's on first? How do who's dress? Who's dressed in lots of bright colors, lots of stripy things, lots of bedazzlers, lots of things hanging off your hats, big floppy things. If you have some instruments like bamboozlers and woo-woozlers and hang-dingers and they had all kinds of, you could make something fun out of a coat hanger and put some tinsel on it or something. If you want to help assist with what we're doing between 3 o'clock and 4 o'clock, drop off bags of individually wrapped candy, because along the parade route, we want to hand out candy. And last year, we ran out after about 100 yards. So my encouragement to the team who's handing out candy is don't do it all in the first 100 feet. And they were like, oh, here, here. And they were like, no, we don't have any candy. So the people at the end of the parade kind of got ripped off, and we didn't look very generous. And we're more generous than that. I think that's all we've got. If you got any kind of announcement you need to do, don't tell me. Come up and speak to me. All right, so with that all said, guess what we're into? Thanksgiving is over, and we're going to start doing a little Christmas celebration. So Miss Mary's going to come up and sing her first song. Do I have to? I've been praying all morning. You people make me crazy. We're going to pray first, and then Mary's going to come up. Father, we just asked you to just be with us today. We ask your spirit to enlighten us every minute of every day. God, I ask those who aren't encouraged to seek you, God, that they would understand that life without you isn't real life at all, but life with you is so fulfilling and so complete. And God, you've made such a change in me that I can't imagine what life would be without you anymore. God, for all you've done and all you continue to do for all of us, God, we come here today, we come to worship you, we come to celebrate the birth of you yourself come down in the flesh as your son Jesus. God, we praise you today, and we give you glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Is empty, no more traffic in the streets, all the builders' tools are silent, no more time to harvest wheat, busy housewives cease their labors, in the courtroom no debate, work on earth has been suspended as the king comes through the gate. The king is coming, the king is coming. I just heard the trumpet sounding. Is coming, the King is coming, praise God, He's coming for me. Happy faces line the hallways, those whose lives have been redeemed, broken homes that He has mended, those from prison He has freed, little children and the aged, hand in hand stand all aglow, who were crippled, broken, marching throng, the flurry of God's trumpets spell the end of sin and wrong. Regal robes are now unfolding, heaven's grand stands all in place, heaven's choir is now assembled, start to coming.
And Dave picked that Gaither one out.
That's right. You should have seen me back there. Gaither. It's nice to have Mary here from Maine, obviously in the backwoods.
But Dave, I learned all these Gaither songs down south.
I love you, though. That's good. She did a great job. She did a great job. There was something I thought of back there, and I forgot it already, so we'll move on. Not yet. I don't think so. I didn't see her yell at me or give me the eye. Where's Wendy? Oh, she's not ready. You let Wendy handle Wendy. All right, onwards and upwards. Put the songbooks out today because this is the only one in the songbooks. But I think you know it. Everybody's asking him for songbooks. I put him in a bad position when we do that. Where's my salt and pepper?
Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King.
Tell you.
Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
this is a new one for Christmas. Good job, girls. Let's hear it for the praise team. These guys, you know, sometimes it's like corralling kittens, but we somehow pull it all together. All right. Now it's time for the kids to go with Miss Wendy. And don't be putting any makeup and costumes on them yet. All right. You guys might want to make some bamboozlers and woozwoozlers and ding-donglers and stuff. Just because I think we need some. I don't know what they are, but I've seen them in a movie. All right. Where are you going? All right. You know, it's really cool to have a ministry that we can reach out to the kids. We're so blessed to have this camper, the motorhome that was given to us. It really makes a big difference for our kids' missions. And Wendy's really thankful for the people that all pitch in. If you have a heart to help with the kids, I'm sure Wendy would love to build a team. So y'all know Wendy by now. If you have a heart to help with that, she's in there every week and she doesn't get to hear the message, so she's starving for God's word, especially from me. But she does like to come out and hear the message once in a while, and we don't want to feed it into the camper because then it'll interfere with what she's doing. But if you have a heart to help kids, go meet up with Wendy and see if we can give her a break once in a while. There's an awful lot going on. It's been a really busy week. Rebecca over here, I'm going to give you away. Where'd she go? She left already. Okay, she stepped out. Rebecca was in the hospital this week. She had some heart issues, and they went in and opened up a blockage in her heart. We have our another friend over here. I forget the name. Virginia. Virginia had a car accident about a week and a half ago, and she's thankful to be here. But there's so many things going on through the holidays. I was at a memorial service yesterday for friends of a family of the friends, actually. In that service, after the service, I spoke to the pastor over there, and they're talking about mission trips to Africa. And I've had our video team ask, when are we going to get involved with doing a mission trip? And, you know, it's really interesting because my heart's always been about that. And here we are right in Fort Pierce. We have missionary flights right at the Fort Pierce Airport, and they take trips down to Haiti several times a week, if not several times a day. So Wendy told me if we get in touch with our Baptist Mission Board, they'll have a program, they'll have somebody who can meet up with. We also have a teacher, a doctor here who's opened up a school, and he's got a place for us to stay and do missionary work there. So we might want to consider doing that. If you have a desire to go help the people in Haiti, if you have a desire to go help the people in South Africa, the Chapel by the Sea, there's Dennis over there, and he's looking to go over to South Africa and do some work there. The pictures he showed me yesterday were of, he said he was driving out to do, the guy who's doing this mission work, he was out there to do some crop dusting or something, and he drove past a dump, and he looked over at the dump. It was a level ground, and I saw some photos of it. It just looked like the city had been obliterated. It was a garbage dump, and there were, if not dozens, probably 100 or 150 kids crawling around the garbage dumps. Part of what they were doing was finding material to build little makeshift sheds so they could live. And the other thing that they were doing was scavenging for food so they could eat. And it really touched his heart that there's some people suffering so badly. A good day's find in the garbage dump would have been two or three mostly rotten tomatoes and some cucumbers that were no longer green and pale but had turned gray. And that's what they had to eat that day. So my heart goes out to kids especially because they're raised up in such a difficult time. I don't know if you've ever been hungry to the point where you did whatever it took to get food. But if you haven't, then be blessed and realize that you're one of few people in the world that's never been in that position. The hunger that we're going to talk about today is a hunger in our soul. And it's a hunger that the reason that God sent his son down to earth was to complete us, to fill that hunger in our soul, to fill the void that was within us. My experience with that was a little over 20 years ago. And I was extremely empty inside, and I didn't know why. I was trying to fill it with a whole lot of things, from alcohol and drugs to women and parties and you name it. I tried everything, and it never seemed to work. And if it did work, it didn't work for long. Every relationship I had was extremely temporary and quite volatile. And I thank God for the wife he put in my life now, who was willing to put up with the turmoil and the storms that I had in my life and accept me for who I am, which wasn't pretty. It wasn't pretty at all. And you know what? Some of it still isn't pretty when we get honest. But I've learned that I can be me and people will love me anyway. I've learned that I've got a lot of stuff I need to work on. And it's looking in the mirror that makes all the difference. But what really made the big difference for me was not just looking in the mirror and realizing I had flaws, but was finding somebody who was able to help me walk through the journey and never have to do it alone and comfort me in the fact that no matter how nasty and how vile my body was, that God loved me anyway and that he wanted something different for me. Those were words that I heard when I said a prayer of salvation, and I didn't even know it. The words that I said in a meeting was, I don't know who God is. And I think that was a revealing statement, and it was part of the journey. And by the time I got home that night, I actually prayed to God, who I didn't know, and asked him for help. And I said, if you don't help, then I'm checking out. And the next morning, my journey started, and it started in a big way. If you haven't heard any of my story, I'm going to do a little shameless plug here. I've got about 30 of my books that I wrote. If you know somebody who's struggling with faith or who's struggling with religious addiction, that means performing but not getting the peace, I wrote a book. It's a simple book. It's 138 pages. It's here. I got 30 of them. Good Christmas present, $10 a piece. Shameless plug. But I've heard that it sat in my computer for about 7 years before somebody asked me why I was robbing people. And I said, what are you talking about? And he said, well, if you had put this out 7 years ago, how many lives may have been changed and how many lives may have been saved? So that was got put the fire under my butt to get it published. I'm self-published now. I don't know how to go through the process of marketing it to a big publisher, but if you have the know-how, please come see me, let me know, and be part of that team, because it's not about me making money on the book. It's about people's lives being changed. I want to see it get out to thousands, if not millions. If I made a penny a piece, I'd be satisfied. If I lost a penny a piece, I'd be satisfied. But I want people to find a heart for God and to find what it is to have a genuine faith. It's called Just Trust. If you never heard of it, it's on the back of our shirts. And I have some here. So after the service, don't interrupt Bob's message, but after the service, hang out. I'll dig the box out. It's here somewhere. I think it got put in the van. Good Christmas stuffer. And if you read it yourself, I think you'll hear my voice. Scary, huh? Better than that, I hope you hear God's voice. So with that all said, we're going to talk about our last study that we're doing in Matthew, and then next week and the week after, we're going to be focused on the theme that we've got in our Christmas parade, which is this. Perhaps Christmas doesn't come from a store. Perhaps Christmas is a little bit more. And that's going to be our focus for the next 2 weeks. But right now, Bob, let's finish up at what we're studying in Matthew and do your thing.
Get those books out, man. They need to see them. Good morning. If anybody has brought those little plastic bags that they're using to make the mats for homeless people, and they need to turn those in. The bag's right over here. Doug's got it. He's our bag model.
Or bring him next Sunday.
You can bring him next Sunday. That's fine. The bag should be here next Sunday, too. So that'll be a good little reminder if you forgot to bring those. And this is going to be our last look in Matthew for a little while, like Dave said. But there's a neat little story here about a very important figure in the Bible. But I wanted to preface this with, as we see Jesus getting near the end of his ministry, and it looks like things are getting very dark as far as what's going to happen with him, we need to understand that God is in control, even when things look, and especially when things look very dark. He knew what was going to happen. He was prepared for it. And when we started this study, we said that he was on a mission, and he stayed focused on that mission. You can go all the way back into Psalms, the very second psalm, in fact. It's a prophecy in a way, for it says, "Why do the nations rage and the people plot a vain thing? The kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us break their bonds in pieces and cast away their cords from us." And it's very true today. Christianity is under attack in a lot of areas, but God's in control. "He who sits in the heavens shall laugh. The Lord shall hold them in derision. Then he shall speak to them in his wrath and distress them in his deep displeasure. Yet I have set my king on my holy hill of Zion." He's talking about Jesus. He's saying Jesus is going to reign. That is God's will. And man isn't going to stop that. Those atheists, secularists, those that hate any reference to God or Jesus, they're not going to control things because God's in control. "I will declare the decree. The Lord has said to me, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will give you the nations for your inheritance and the ends of the earth for your possession. Christ is going to rule. Christ is going to come back and rule again. In fact, he's in charge now. It's just the way he chooses to manifest himself in the world is through you and me, through believers living in us and guiding us to do his will. So we come to Matthew chapter 26, and starting in verse 1, it says, "Now it came to pass, when Jesus had finished all these sayings, that he said to his disciples, you know that after 2 days is the Passover, and the Son of Man will be delivered up to be crucified." He told them straight out what was going to happen. And we see them either ignore it or not pay attention. And part of the reason is we don't like to accept things that we don't want to accept. If it doesn't fit with what our plan, the paradigm that we have, the little mental map that we've laid out, the way things ought to be, if it doesn't fit with that, then there's a human tendency to discard what we don't want to see. This is why you'll never win a political argument, because it's our nature to latch on to things that support what we want to believe, support our position, and to discount anything that goes contrary to our position. And I think that the disciples weren't ready to see that Jesus' kingdom is spiritual. They really wanted to see the kingdom brought in now. What's going to happen in the future, Christ coming victoriously, the end of time, establishing his reign, they thought it was going to be then, and they didn't like to hear things that didn't go along with that. Then the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders of the people, the religious rulers, we see it again and again. It lays it out. It tells us the religious authorities, those that have put themselves on the pedestal to condemn other people, to tell other people how to live, but they won't look at their own hearts. They assembled at the palace of the high priest, who was called Caiaphas. And we just read in Psalms about rulers setting themselves against God. Well, here, listen to what the religious leaders, the ones that the people would expect be expected to look up to and listen to, listen to what they think about Jesus, and plotted to destroy him. They plotted to take Jesus by trickery, it says, and kill him. Pretty serious stuff. Pretty serious stuff. And we see over in John, he describes this scenario in chapter 11 in a little more detail. Then the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered a council and said, you know, like today it'd be a committee. You know, let's get a committee together. What shall we do? For this man works many signs. If we let him alone like this, everyone will believe in him. Oh my gosh, can you imagine that? They're worried that the people are going to believe in the Son of God. They'll believe in him, and the Romans will come and take away both our place and nation. So it's their positions of authority that's threatened. You know, when people are living the good life, they'll go to almost any ends to protect that, whatever means they're living the good life by, from being taken away from them. And one of them, Caiaphas, being high priest that year, said to them, "You know nothing at all, nor do you consider that it is expedient for us that one man should die for the people and not that the whole nation should perish." He didn't even know what he said. His motive for saying that was purely selfish. But see, he was still in a position that God had sanctioned as being a high priest. And he also spoke truth about Jesus that he didn't even understand. For in verse 51, it says, "Now this he did not say on his own authority, but being high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the nation, and not only for that, but also that he would gather together in one the children of God who were scattered abroad." prophecy right out of the mouth who of the one who's planning and plotting to take Jesus and kill him. God's in control. God knows what he's doing. So Jesus, he goes and he visits with some friends. It says back in Matthew 26:6, and when Jesus was in Bethany at the house of Simon the leper, now this is the leper that he had healed from that dreadful disease, a woman came to him having an alabaster flask of very costly fragrant oil, and she poured it on his head as he sat at the table. But when his disciples saw it, they were indignant, saying, "Why this waste?" This is Jesus that they're talking about. And yet, this woman, out of the purity of her heart, Mary of Bethany, some biblical scholars, there's some disagreement on this, some believe that Mary of Bethany, the sister of Martha, was also Mary Magdalene. And Mary Magdalene, Jesus had healed, it said there were seven evil spirits. And whether that was demonic possession or mental illness, or they probably go together, she was very distressed. She was in a horrific condition, and Jesus cleansed her, and she followed Jesus for the rest of her life. And I don't know, I've researched it a little bit, if this is the same Mary or not, but this Mary of Bethany has a very special place in the Bible in and of herself. The disciples are focused on conflict. And if you don't think that competition happens within the church, then your eyes aren't open, because unfortunately there's a lot of fleshly things that happen within the church just like there is outside. And what it is when believers forget where their focus ought to be, and that happened even with the disciples. We've seen it before where they were competing and jockeying for position. But this woman, Mary, takes this very expensive alabaster jar that's filled with spikenard oil, and that spikenard oil cost almost as much as what a year's wages would be. So in today's terms, all right, this is Fort Pierce, so let's say, you know, let's say it was worth $20,000. Okay, that's an easily conservative figure, that this oil was worth $20,000. She had saved it, okay, for the day that it would be used in a very special way. Over in, I think it's in John, back in John again, it says, particularly points at Judas. It says, Judas says, "Why was this fragrant oil not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor?" Righteous indignation. You ever seen somebody do something good, but somebody else has to get on a high horse and put a spin on it with a little sarcasm or a little self-righteousness? That's what's going on here. And it wasn't, the Bible tells us, that Judas was concerned about the poor one little bit. He was the one that was sort of the treasurer for Jesus and the disciples as they traveled around. He had the money box, and he was dipping into that money box. And he was very upset to see money that could have gone into his fingers be used in this way. But Jesus is honored by this. He understands the significance and points out the significance. He says, "Why do you trouble the woman? For she has done a good work for me. For you have the poor with you always, but me you do not have always." There's always going to be poor. We have had in the past what's called a war on poverty, and it's noble to make efforts, and Christ commends us to work with the poor and minister to the poor. All the way back in Deuteronomy, it says that you're going to have the poor with you and take out of what you've been blessed. And he's not telling the government, it's telling us. A lot of people want to put it off on the government, and they feel good about that because they feel like they're supporting a good cause, but as long as it's not directly out of their pocket. But in Deuteronomy, all the way back in the Old Testament, it tells us people, individuals, out of what we've been blessed with to help the poor. And it even goes further. It says that if you have a slave for 6 years, you set him free after that. But you don't only just set them free, you give them a place to live and you set them up so that they can make a living in their freedom. You empower them, you give them things because you've been blessed. And this is Old Testament culture, but I can tell you that when slave owners in America back in our history would take a little scripture out of context in order to justify slavery, they didn't preach the whole scripture that said you set them free and you give them things so they can make a living. No, they took things out of context, and that's what the legalists did back in Jesus' day. They would take things out of context. They would get on a religious high horse. So Jesus goes on. He says, "For in pouring this fragrant oil on my body, she did it for my burial. Assuredly, I say to you, wherever this gospel is preached in the whole world, what this woman has done will also be told as a memorial to her." And it is, because we're talking about her today. Jesus said that would happen, and we're doing it. Mary of Bethany was focused on not the busybodiness, not her sister running around taking care of stuff, which things have to get taken care of, but she was at the feet of Jesus. She was pouring the oil on his head, pouring the oil on his feet, wiping it away with her hair, staring into her master's eyes, getting her needs met where they can be met at the deepest level. And that's the lesson I believe that Mary of Bethany gives us and speaks down to us today. Jesus is where our needs are going to get met. We can get involved in all kinds of projects. We can get involved in all kinds of busyness. And we can get so busy that we're just bitter at each other because we're worn to a frazzle. But if we don't put Jesus first, we're missing the point. It's about him. This is the woman that Jesus honored. Look at her life and examine it for yourself and see what it means for us today.
Very good. I guess when I think about my life before I accepted this gift of Christ, it was I was all about so many of those things, trying to go get my job going, trying to earn that next day's pay, trying to get a woman in my life who would appreciate me for everything that I would give her, stuff, junk. There was a time when I lived up in Maine, and I looked around at all the belongings I had, but I was emotionally a wreck. I was relationally a wreck. I was spiritually dead and had a whole lot of toys. And the thing that we talk about in all of our training is how temporary the things of this world are. And temporary, unfortunately, might be 30 years that you've had satisfaction with something. But when it's over, it still was temporary. Temporary is anything that's not eternal. And what Mary was focused on here was the eternal life of Christ. She was focused on a faith that made a difference to her. I've had options in my life. My dad and I had some differences of opinion with what religion and faith meant. And he used to try and convince me that I was foolish. And he said, "Well, you know, that religion is like Dumbo's magic feather. As long as you hold on to it, it works." And it didn't make sense to me that he was looking at it in a reverse format. You know, if it works, what's wrong with holding on to it? If you're a cripple, a crutch isn't a bad thing. You know, if you need help, then help isn't a bad thing. If I'm incomplete and I'm empty inside and God can fill me, then how could God ever be a bad thing? But see, he had a difference of opinion because he was brought up in a performance mode. And if you don't pray, and if you don't do this, and if you don't do that, and if you're not doing this, and if you're not reading, and if, and I understand now where his difficulty came in. When God got a hold of my heart, he changed me. And I went into a lot of different types of religions and ministries that didn't make sense to me. But I wanted to find what God had for me. I didn't want to find what man had for me. Because I did that in my past life. I was all about manipulating people to get my need met temporarily. And I got into some churches that, I'm not saying that they were bad, but for me, I didn't understand. I didn't understand what was going on. I didn't understand the speaking in tongues thing. I didn't understand that every Wednesday at 7, God comes down and heals. And that I have to do it next Wednesday too. And I can come back up the following Wednesday and rededicate and rededicate and rededicate. And it didn't make sense to me, and it didn't blend with the spirit that moved into my heart on the day that he did. So my words and my prayer and all of those actions that I didn't understand, and it would be my encouragement to you, is this. God, if this is from you, I want it all. But God, if this isn't you, then protect me. I want you to show me the truth. I want you to show me you in my life. I don't want to be in performance mode. I don't want to be trying to fit in with a crowd anymore. I did it all my life, and it killed me. I was a people pleaser. I did stand-up comedy. I mean, how desperate is that? You know, I wanted so hard, so much for people to love me for my actions, to love me because I would do for them. And I would get people to the point I needed them to need me, because if you need me, you can't throw me away anymore. And it's so much better when people want me in their life. It's so much different to be comfortable, to not have to be on perform mode and be accepted. And God is the one that did that. My prayer, which wasn't a prayer at all, but my heart's desire in my past, was to have friends all around me. I was always throwing parties that nobody would show up to. And it'd start out with a big plan, and it would turn into a pity party. When they did show up, I'd wake up out of a drunken stupor and half my stuff was stolen. Friends. Good friends. I have a hard time convincing some of the people that come to the counseling office that the people you think are your friends are really your customers. And they're getting something from you every single time, maybe. Maybe your friends would want what was best for you instead of trying to take from you all the time. Maybe your friends are your customers. I know that when I didn't have all the goodies in my pocket and stashed in my trunk, there weren't a whole lot of people around. But when I was offering up a good time, it seemed like everybody wanted to be there then. Oh, and they'll pay me later, by the way. Yeah, it was just what we did, right? But life changed when I accepted the gift that God sent down. Now, my forgiveness, I understand now, I was forgiven over 2,000 years ago, and so were you. I didn't accept it till 1994, but I was forgiven 2,000 years plus. When I accepted it is when God started to show me what he wanted to do in my life. I thank him that he kept me out of the craziness of some of the religions that I looked at. I thank him that he gave me a spirit inside that said, this isn't feeding who I am. And when you go to a place to get fed and you walk away hungry, you won't go there very often, will you? But when I went to God, he fed me. And when I went home and I got alone with him, he fed me. I had a lot of people... Great idea. Listen to Christian radio. Listen to Christian music. Listen to WCNO. There's some great teachers on there. Turn on TBN. There's great teachers on there. And there are. But for me, I got confused because I'd hear in a day six different opinions about one Bible verse. And I couldn't figure out which one was right. And then I'd hear words in songs, and I'd go to some churches, and what I didn't understand is God saved me. It was so awesome to know God. And then I'd go to these churches with rooms full of quote-unquote believers, and yet every song is about, oh, God, I'm a wicked wretch. You know, save me from this pit I'm in. And it didn't seem encouraging at all. It seemed like they weren't believing that God already saved them. And I didn't understand it. If he entered into your heart, the Bible in Romans 6 says that you're dead and you're raised up a brand new creation who is now holy and without blame. The experiences of your flesh are what's killing you. God doesn't hate you. He hates the things that are keeping you from being free. God isn't angry with you. He's angry at the stuff that's clouding your way to be free. God loves you. He doesn't like the sin. And the sin, simplest format, is when you're not walking, trusting God. Sin is an attitude of unbelief. Here's what it sounds like. I got this. Pretty simple, right? I'll be okay if I can just. And I start counting on me instead of God again. God has done miraculous things in this life, and I know he's done miraculous things in some of your lives. Why not continue to follow him? Why do we go into performance mode? Why do we get our traditions? I hope it ruffles feathers. I hope it does. But just this morning when I'm ready to start up, aren't you going to pray first? I mean it when I say I've been talking to God all morning. Pastor, will you say grace? God hears your prayer too. I got pastor in front of my name, and it's a title that doesn't put me on a pedestal. He doesn't hear me any more than he hears you. You can pray. Matter of fact, my Bible says pray without ceasing. It means communicate with God all day long. I jokingly go to, someone will invite me to dinner. Well, do you want to say the blessing? I said, I've been praying all the way over here. Oh, really? And you get this big smile because the pastor's praying for me. I said, yeah, I don't know how you cook. And it's meant to be an icebreaker. God wants us communicating with him all the time, and when we're hearing his voice and we're being led in the simplest things, life gets better. One step at a time. Bob spoke this a couple of years ago, and it just stays in my head. His word, his living word that speaks to my heart, his written word that speaks to my heart through reading, his word is a lamp unto my feet. When I'm walking in darkness, I stumble around and I run into things and I fall. But when I have the lamp at my feet and he's guiding my next step, I'm safe. I'm secure. He has a plan. If I'm following his steps each time, where do you suppose it's going to bring me? If you're following his steps each time, where do you suppose it's going to bring you? Is it going to bring you into a pit of despair? No. He has life and life more abundant for you. This is what Mary was celebrating. She knew in her heart, somehow, this is the one. Jesus is the one. He needs to be honored. He needs to be put on a... He's the only one worthy of being on the pedestal. He's the only one worthy of making this life that is such a mess pure and clean. He's the only one who can do it. He's the Lamb who was sent to be sacrificed so that every man could be forgiven, so that every man could be made clean. By the way, not just the people of Israel. This is for the Gentiles too. Every man has an opportunity. When I meet somebody on the street, he's my brother. Whether he knows it or not, whether he believes by faith or not, is not my concern. I've had people say, why do you call him brother? Is he a believer? If he's not, the only difference is he doesn't know it yet. And if I can't accept these poor people, these homeless people, these other than people as my brother, then who will? If they can't find love from one of God's people, how are they going to find God's love? God is working through you to show his love. He didn't come to abolish the law. He didn't come to make us perform for the Ten Commandments. He didn't come to make sure we're not doing bad and make sure we're doing good. He came to fulfill the law by leading in our hearts with his Spirit us into his righteousness. The fruits of the Spirit are God's. Your position is to remain attached to the vine. Jesus said, I am the vine. You are the branches. Without me, you have no life. The branches that do not produce fruit for God, God will trim them off. Trust him. God is going to remove those. And they'll wither and they'll die. And I'll come back to that. The branches, the parts of you that do produce fruit for God, guess what happens to them? God is going to tend to them so that they produce more. That doesn't sound difficult, does it? Do you hear how Jesus might say, my burden is light, my yoke is easy, trust me? Stop taking on the challenges of the world, the challenges of the religion, the challenges of your denomination, and trust God to lead you into righteousness. It's him that's going to do it. Your performance is nothing if you're not doing it as led of God. You know, we're unhappy people. You guys know it. I don't know what you griped about today, but I bet it changed over the last week. And I remember I was called somebody on it this morning, you know. Why, my gosh, I got this job. They're working me to death. You know what? 6 months ago, your complaint was you didn't have any work. Was that an answered prayer or is it a curse? You know? And that's what we are. Oh, my gosh, it's too windy. Oh, it's too hot. Oh, it's too cold. Oh, it's too rainy. It's too dry. It's too this. Stop. I've encouraged people in counseling, and I will encourage you. Get a steno pad. I know they're hard to find because we don't have stenographers much anymore, but get a steno pad, one of the ones that flips over the top. Start with simple things. Put it on your bedstand. Gratitude list. What do you have to be thankful for? I can see. There's a great one. I can hear. I can breathe. I had food today. I have people who care about me. Start with the simple stuff. And when you find yourself complaining, go get out your gratitude list. And remember, this is the simpleness of counting your blessings. Count your blessings. I'm going to tell you the gift of God that was given to me and my wife. Come on, just get real, guys. Stop griping. Look at the stuff she's done for you. Stop worrying about the stuff you feel like she's doing against you. Chances are that might be what you expect. If you expect to be miserable, guess what you're going to be? Miserable. Yeah. If you expect to be treated like you're no good, what else do you expect? Expectations will lead to failures and disappointment every single time. It's mentioned hear about the fragrant oil. Bob related oil last week to the Spirit within us. Mary anointed him with the fragrant oil. This was in preparation for his death, knowing that it was time. See, they didn't have embalming fluid and stuff back then. In order to take care of a body, they would put strong scented oils on it so that the odors of death don't waft through the neighborhood. That's what the whole point was. The disciples were missing the significance. They got angry. And Bob put in his study, they got on their religious high horse. You know, yeah, I know it's about grace, but brother, if you're not performing right, God's going to send you to hell. Wait a minute. I was saved 20 years ago. Who are you to make that decision? I'm not so sure that I can throw away my salvation. My Bible says that once I'm in the hand of God, nobody can snatch me out of it. Nobody, I think, includes me. Now, I'm not telling you you can do whatever, well, I'm not telling you you can do bad and not have some consequences, but I can tell you this, God isn't rejecting you, he just doesn't like what you're doing at the time. God isn't going to lay guilt and shame on you because he came to remove guilt and shame. He wants you to know that when you're struggling, it's safe to run to him. It's okay to run to Dad. But I can only speak from a male perspective. But, you know, us men, we're survivors. Us men, we're supposed to be strong. Us men, we're not supposed to cry. Us men, we can't show weakness. Us men, we don't need anybody. But you're wrong on one count. We need the Spirit of Jesus in us. Because without him, we don't know forgiveness. We don't know gentleness. We don't know mercy. We don't know grace. We don't know compassion. We don't know that sometimes we're wrong. And that's a hard thing to say. I'm wrong. Please forgive me. Real strong man has a hard time doing the hardest thing there is, and that's apologizing sometimes. Apparently they didn't take Jesus seriously about his impending crucifixion. They didn't believe him when he said, my time is short here. And they were kind of like, I don't know, I guess if you think about it, I was a little concerned this morning because Mark's usually right on time. And I called to check on him and I thought, wow, you know, I just did a funeral service yesterday who at a very young age suddenly passed. And then I heard this lady over here had a heart attack and I'm like, Mark, I'm just calling. I hope he answers his phone. I'm not that negative, but, you know, hey, you never know. We get so accustomed to having our loved ones there and just, oh, yeah, he'll be here, no problem. I actually forget sometimes, and people are like, you know, dude, you didn't even ask me. You didn't invite me. Well, you just showed up anyway. That's who you are. You show up. And all of a sudden, one day when somebody doesn't show up, you kind of wonder if they're okay. So I called Mark. I said, you okay? Oh, you just don't want to set up that sound system yourself. I said, you know? No, Mark. Quit being a man and hear it for what it is. I care about you, man. I was concerned. It's hard for us guys to do that without putting a joke on it and making it like, you know, I have my friend Denny who loved me better than any man in the world. He loved me and he meant it. And when he grabbed a hold of me and gave me a hug, you know what? I needed it. And I wasn't ashamed of having love. There's so much fear of, oh my God, maybe he's kind of weird. Maybe he's a little light in the loafers, whatever. Stop it. You need love. And you need the love of godly men in your life. You need it. Again, I can only speak from a man's perspective. And I fail to do the same thing for my wife. Because of fear of rejection. Because of fear that maybe it won't be accepted with what I want. Maybe it'll be accepted as a manipulation. Because that's who I used to be. And I don't want to manipulate anymore. I want to be able to show people I love them. And it's a challenge I have. And you want it too. If you can't admit it, then pray on it for a while. But I know you want it too. Every single one of us hungers for love, and we hunger for perfect love. Jesus stood up and he defended and honored Mary's gift. Oh, look at these two hugging over in the corner. You know what, dude? Feels good to be loved. You can get all tweaked on it if you want, but it feels good to be loved. I need it, and so do you. And if you can't admit it, then I'll pray for you. Because the fact is, you need it too. That's our problem in life. I don't need nobody. I don't need nothing. I got this. Really? Who's your God now? If your words are, I got this, then maybe you're counting on the wrong power. Maybe. That's between you and God. Here's my thought. God, if this is from you, I want it. God, if this isn't from you, protect me from it. God, if this is what you want in my life, I want it all. Pour it into me. God, if it's not what you want in my life, then protect me. Thank you, God, for protecting me. Thank you, God, for feeding me. Thank you, God, for putting people in my life who care. Thank you, God, for my next breath. Without you, I'm dead. I was a walking zombie, and I didn't even know it. Thank you, God, for putting your life in me. It's no longer me that lives. It's you in me. Thank you, God, for the changes that you bring about. Thank you. That's why we celebrate the coming of the Messiah. That's why we celebrate the coming of the Lamb. That's why we celebrate God in the flesh. To put an end to the contract of the law that was meant to bring us to a point of dying to ourselves and turning to God. And when you turn to God, you now can live under his grace, forgiven completely, washed clean, and by faith you can change what you believe according to his word instead of according to your experiences. Father, as we close this service, it's my heart's biggest desire that every heart here would open up to you and invite you in, not just to reside, not just to use as a vending machine, push the button and you get service, but God, as a way of life, as a guide, as a step-by-step instructional, your spirit leading us. God, to open our hearts to love, to open our hearts to caring, to open our hearts to forgiveness, to open our hearts to one another, and get honest that we're wounded and we need support. God, for all that you do, I can't say thank you enough for using me, this simple guy who came from a gutter, to minister your word. God, your word says that you use the foolish things of this world to confound the wise. And I don't get it, but I'm thankful that you use me in every way that you can. I love you, and we're here to praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Doug and Kat are going to set up communion. By the way, we do have a family in need that I've been made aware of. There are three children in the family. I have the details at the office, but there are three children that are going to go pretty much without Christmas if we don't step up, and I think we could all pitch in a little bit and make sure that they're satisfied, meet a need. So if you have a desire to do that, grab a bulletin, call me tomorrow. I'll be in the office, and just I'll give you the details. I think I have ages and sizes of the kids. There's two girls and a boy. And we just want to bless somebody over this holiday. So if you have a heart to do that, get with me and we'll make something happen for them. Communion set up over here on the corner while we do our next Christmas song.
Oh, my deep and dreamless.
few more weeks and we celebrate. For Show Me the Way, it's up to Mark. Something just went haywire in the soundboard. Something went wrong with the system. We may have to wait. Okay. You want to call it, Mark? We blow a horn or something? Oh no. So sorry. It's the music that cut out. All right. Don't know. You want to try and pull it up or just call it? Yeah, there's something wrong with the system. He's got to do some tech work. Sorry. God bless you. See us over at the office today around 3 o'clock is when we'll be ready for people to show up. If you want to help put it together, we might be there by 2. We're going to be using staple guns and decorating, and you might want to be there by 1:30. So anyway, that's the plan. God bless you. Have a good day. And remember, trust God above all.